Okay, thank you very much for attending my talk. Can people in the back hear me? That's a good thing. My name is Alex. I am a PhD student at the University of Texas at Arlington. I'm in Matt Fujita's lab, and broadly speaking, our lab studies the origins and diversity and evolution of diversity. So I do study hybrid systems, but I don't study hybridization per se, maybe distinguishing myself in this particular section. So I'm going to discuss today a chapter of my dissertation in which I describe the possibility for multiple origins of this all-female hybrid lizard system in describing its phenotypic diversity. So very quickly, I'll just refresh our memory here. We're now using phylogenetic data in multiple applications to talk about trait evolution, just as an intro there. So this is one paper among many. This is from Paul Chippendale and friends, in which he showed multiple origins for the origin of direct development in some plethodontid or lungless salamanders. So that's what you're seeing down here. This is a Eurasia salamander in which the juveniles have external gills and the adults do as well. And this is different from most amphibians, which have a biphasic life cycle. And so you actually see even a reversion in some of the desmognathes salamanders. I'm focusing on lizards. I just put this slide up here to emphasize how we're using phylogeny to talk about diversity in traits. And so similarly, I'm going to be talking about the phenotypic diversity in this all-female lizard system. So this is a really cool system. I love to talk about it, so if I go over time, you'll have to stop me. So if you squint and tilt your head a little bit, maybe spin around a few times, you can see within this one species, there's a diversity in the scale patternation on the dorsum, on the back, as well as color pattern differences between these different pattern classes. This is from an important paper published in the 60s by Richard Zweifel, in which he described these six-letter pattern classes. Now, it turns out this situation is more complicated than he originally thought, because it turns out that two of these pattern classes, A and B, are triploid variants, whereas the rest of them are diploid. And among the four remaining pattern classes, one has been given its own name, debatable whether or not that's truly its own species, because it appears so different. So the stripe patterning down the back is broken up so heavily it's given its own name. So I'm focusing on the diploid variant in my talk today, and I'm investigating whether or not multiple origins of the species could be responsible for this diversity. The reason I can talk about multiple origins is because, like most unisexual vertebrate species, species is a term used loosely, this is a hybrid system. So it's known to be a hybrid. It's a fairly recent origin, 10 to 50,000 years ago. And so in the middle, you have the all-female parthenogenetic hybrid lizard. It's called Aspidoscelis tessellata. And on the left and right, you have the two species which we think have hybridized to form in an F1 and all-female parthenogenetic species. So on the left, you have Aspidoscelis eulerus, and on the right, Marmorata. And based on karyotype and mitochondrial evidence, we highly suspect that Aspidoscelis eulerus is the father species or paternal ancestor, and on the right, Marmorata is the maternal ancestor. And so to cut down on all the word soup of species names, I usually refer to these as the father, hybrid, and mother, respectively, just to keep things simple for you guys. So to test this, I collected lizards throughout their known ranges. So these are found in the United States and southwestern United States. I live over here in Texas. This looks close, but this is several hundred miles. And so you can see I have lizards throughout all of their known ranges. These are color coordinated. So red on the left here corresponds with red on the right. So up at the top we have the father, Eularis. In the middle we have the mother, Marmorata. And at the bottom we have the hybrid, Tessellata. And so these are animals either I collected or museums donated tissue to me. And in order to collect data for my analyses, I use the popular trending technique of double digest restriction-associated DNA sequencing, or DD-RAD-seq. I won't dwell on this briefly. You use restriction enzymes, in this case two, in combination to digest away the genome. The idea is to subsample the genome. That way you reduce the amount of information you're sequencing, so you can increase the amount of sequence per site, and then you can multiplex individuals, basically sequence the same sites across multiple individuals. That's the idea here. I then pass these data through filtering for quality, the suite of programs, which is collectively called STAX, and then from there, this is what's sort of different, I accumulate two data sets, and I'm going to talk about this mother plus hybrid data set, and this father plus hybrid data set. And those are what I'm going to use for clustering analyses. I then pass those data sets through some Perl scripts, which output standard phylogenetic alignment files, phylib, FASTA, Nexus, etc., and perform these clustering algorithms. And so I'm going to be talking a bit about this clustering algorithm method called DAPC, which stands for Discriminant Analysis of Principal Components. Some of you are probably familiar with this. This is a variant of the principal components analysis. The distinction between PCA and DAPC is that DAPC aims to maximize variance between groups and minimize variance within groups. So you're looking for differences between the groups. That's the bottom line here. Now, I have a parallel data set that I presented at last year's Evolution Conference in Raleigh. That's shown on the left here. This is a gene tree from the entire mitochondrial genome of about 40 lizards, all Aspidoscelis. I've grouped all of the father species down here at the bottom. Of course, mitochondria are maternally inherited, and so this only tells us about the maternal origins of that hybrid species. And what's important about this figure is that in blue we've got the mother species, in red we've got the hybrid. I tend to infer that there's one, perhaps two, I'm still not sure about this individual, origin on the maternal side of things. So the phenotypic diversity, in my opinion, is not being well explained by multiple origins on the maternal side of things, based on mitochondrial data. And so when I do my DAPC, I wanted to first see, is the DAPC able to distinguish between species? And so with the maternal plus hybrid data set, I find that it is. And so this is an artificially reduced number of clusters. So I said only find two clusters of animals. And it very consistently identified on the left here, Marmorata, the maternal ancestor, and the hybrid, which is on the right in red here. And so DAPC is a very complex modeling paradigm. Like any model, it should be well parameterized, otherwise you will get junk output. And so one first thing that I have to do, DAPC uses as input principal components which are derived from the DNA itself. So you have to actually tell the analysis, the discriminant function, which is its output, how many principal components to use as input. So what you do is you use the whole data set and subsample that data and use replicates of that subsampling across different numbers of principal components. And what you're looking for is a sweet spot, basically a peak. And that's what you see right here with the certain number of principal components going into your final discriminant function. One should also test to see how many clusters actually are in your data. This is kind of the most important part, right? However, to search for a correct number of clusters is sort of a fool's errand. And what you instead have to do is use some information criterion, in this case, the Bayesian information criterion, to select what is the best trade-off of the amount of parameterization, which in this case is the number of groups, to the amount of data that you're explaining with that number of groups. And so ideally, you'd see groups, you explain more data, and as you increase groups, you're over-parameterizing. Now, in reality, it's more messy than that, and so you must eventually pick a trade-off. I'll actually move this arrow down here into the old version. Anyway, so for some actual data, first I'll go through the mother plus hybrid data set, because I already have parallel data to kind of back up any conclusions here. This is a DAPC result, the first two principal components. 10 principal components are retained, about half of the variance is explained, and this looks a bit messy until you map the known hybrid, the known species onto these clusters. And so remember, this is highly dimensional. I'm only showing the first two dimensions, and what you see on across the first principal, the first discriminant function, which is on the x-axis, you have a tessellated group, a marmorated group, and a tessellated group, and some that are somewhat intermediate between the two. So when you compress on the first axis, I'm convinced that this really shows pretty much the same result. There's one origin in this group. Now, when you look at the father plus hybrid group, it gets a little more complicated. So we have similar statistics here, 8 principal components instead of 10, about half the variance explained. And now, when you map species, so this is what's really interesting. This is rather complicated. In red, we have Eulerus, the father. So there's a couple of distinct groups here, 1 and 2. And then for tessellated, the hybrid, in green, we've got 1 and 2. And then you have a few that are made up of both the hybrid and the father. So this, to me, suggests, at the most conservative, that there's more population structure in the father than in the mother, just broadly speaking. But also, we could be looking at multiple paternal origins of this species, this hybrid species. And I'm going to finish by describing very, very briefly a result that I'm working on right now. This is a technique in which I want to take the hybrid data, in this case, 80 base pair long phase data, and we often sequence heterozygotes in those data, which we know are real because they're hybrids, and I'd like to basically map those or fit them onto the parent species to create data sets that are uniquely mother-like parts and uniquely father-like parts, and basically run standard phylogenetic analyses on that. I'm working on that right now, and if you'd like to talk with me later, you're welcome to do so. This is a highly collaborative project. I just want to briefly thank my collaborators. Rich Adams helped me with that last line there. Jessica Majeed helped me collect a lot of animals in the field, and notable sources of funding would be the National Science Foundation and the SSC. And if I have time for questions, I'll take them. Otherwise, catch me after the meeting. Thank you.
Do we have time for more questions?
Yes. In the back. Yes.
Yeah,
Yeah, that's a really interesting point. There's this weedy species hypothesis that goes with unisexual vertebrates, and it seems to be that they occupy a different habitat niche than either of the parents. They like more disturbed habitat, and if you know New Mexico well, those are where you find the river systems, which infrequently are flooded with water. So, yeah, they seem to prefer the more disturbed habitats, but they do overlap somewhat. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, are the nucleic clusters within Gularis also geographically structured, or is it rather geographic structure within Gularis?
You know, interestingly, it's not, but I will say, if you were looking very carefully, you may have noticed that I didn't subsample most of, actually, Mexico's Gularis distribution. That's work I'm going to be doing in the future. I've been able to go to Mexico to collect the animals. So, I don't want to say that there isn't, but in the 3 subspecies out of 7 that I've collected, there isn't a lot of matchup there, which is really surprising to me. So thank you.
I think we can still take one more.
So, it seems like the hybridization actually involved multiple generations of hybridization that might have started with an individual that's not parthenogenetic. Would you say that makes sense with having multiple fathers?
Multiple fathers? So I'm still not sure how one could have one maternal origin and multiple paternal origins yet. That's kind of really new to me. So So I'm not sure what's going on there. I will say that based on lab data from Peter Bauman's lab, they're able to generate F1 parthenogenetic lineages in the lab. They have 14 lineages or species, many of which you don't find in the wild. And those are with one father, not multiple fathers. So I don't know that it's necessary. Is it possible? Perhaps. But that would be very surprising to me.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much.